Listen, John Cola with growingyourgreens.com. Today we have another exciting episode for you coming at you from my beautiful backyard garden on a beautiful January day. It's been like literally the low 70s today. It's been so amazing. I've been working out in the garden planting more sugar snap peas, sugar ands in my garden today. But what I thought I'd do for you guys next is what I've been doing off camera, but I had a few requests for me to make a video about the process to show how I use some of the kale that I grow. So this whole bed of kale, there's like over 100 plants in here, and up until this year, I never have cooked it. I always eat it raw. I'll harvest the young baby leaves, like the center leaves, slice them up really thin, and finally put them into a salad, and I will eat them. And then the larger leaves off to the outside, I usually just harvest and then actually juice them to get those nutrients into me. So pretty much this whole garden bed feeds me. Oh, and then if I have extra kale, you know, like I can't eat it all, like juicing or eating it fresh, then I will harvest it and turn it into kale chips. And actually that is my goal for my curly kale and my my burgundy kale. That's actually the purple. It's kind of ruffly, so it actually holds on to some of the dressing better. And I have videos on how I juice this. I have videos on how I dehydrate this into kale chips. I also have videos on how I eat this raw and just make a salad out of it. And I even have videos on how I just will make a little dip with nuts and some fruits and go around with it and then pick a leaf and dip it in and eat it just in my garden without even having to make a salad. But this is the first time on video ever that I'm gonna show you guys actually the best way to cook your kale. If you might think I'm a little bit peculiar for not cooking my kale or anything, because I know most of you guys might cook your kale up, and that's just the common way people eat them. But based on my research, the best way to eat your kale plants is actually by not cooking them. They are completely edible raw, although you may have issues digesting them if you're not used to eating raw kale, and that's a whole different discussion that I'm not going to talk about. So if you are new to eating, to not cooking your kale to get it in you, I recommend juicing it, because juicing breaks down some of the fibers and basically blows open the nutrients into the juice so that now you can absorb it and obtain the nutrition from it. And when you heat foods, you basically denature proteins, you can create carcinogens, create toxins, as well as lower antioxidant compounds. And especially with the kales, if you don't cook them properly, you can lose many of the beneficial anti-cancer benefits from the isothiocyanates, although you still will have the glucosinolates in there. So the reason why I'm cooking my kale finally is because my parents used to live in the next state over, and due to COVID and other reasons, they moved a little bit closer to me. So now they're literally a 15-minute drive away. And what I've been doing is, you know, especially as you get more mature in your age, you know, you should definitely be eating healthier and healthier as you get older and older, because you definitely need all the nutrients and phytonutrients, especially anti-cancer properties in the kale, and more importantly, the anti-aging properties in the kale. Like literally, kale is anti-cancer and anti-age, and it's gonna keep you young forever if you eat enough of it. And my parents don't necessarily like to drink juice, and they don't like to necessarily have salads of kale. I was making salads only for my parents, and then they complained like, oh, don't make us salads, we didn't like the last one. So I'm like, all right. So then I just started cooking the kale, and they haven't complained. Plus, the other thing is that I would see them go to Whole Foods and buy cooked kale and cooked other food items from the Whole Foods deli, which, you know, when you're buying things pre-prepared, you cannot control, number one, how the food was grown. And, you know, I grew all these by my bare two hands and using the best organic soil, adding in trace minerals, foliar feeding, crazy things like phytoplankton and kelp and compost tea and different microbes, so I could grow the healthiest food that literally money cannot buy. So I want them to eat healthy, and they're just buying stuff at Whole Foods where they might add, you know, sugar and oil and salt to some of the recipes, make it taste good, so you buy more of it. And like, I didn't want none of that for my parents. I want them to have good, clean, healthy, nutrient-dense food that literally money cannot buy. So who better to do it than their eldest son, because the youngest son doesn't grow a garden, and probably I don't think my brother knows how to cook either. So I'm gonna do that for him and step up so that my parents could eat healthier. And also, more importantly, because they are on Social Security and retired now, they could save money, because literally I'm just gonna make the food for them. Now, in addition to you know, harvesting some of the kale I'm growing. I also bought organic food and I also pre-cook other food for them. So every week I'll, you know, bring over from 2 to maybe 8 jars, mason jar, quart jars of food for them for the week. So I literally do meal prep for me, and now I get to do meal prep for my parents. And you know, if you guys have somebody important in your family, or even a friend of yours that's, you know, your parents or your siblings or your children, I would encourage you guys to make the healthiest food for them. When you're making it for yourself, make a little bit extra and deliver it to them so that they could also eat healthy. And because, you know, I know as gardeners, you guys have extra food grown because you're following what I teach and you're doing the practices I do. I say, you know, like adding the rock dust, adding the compost, these, all these things, and you have so much food, more food than you can't eat. So what better thing can you do is to share it with others. And if you don't have any family or friends, then, you know, make it and then try to donate it to people that are in need, you know, people that are unhomed or, you know, whoever else, right? So anyways, let's get into this video. The first step is I need to harvest my kale. So how I do this generally is, you know, especially when I'm cooking my kale, I don't grab the baby leaves, I grab all the older mature leaves. My goal is to not have any leaves on the bottom of the plant that turn brown and then I have to compost. I'd rather get them into my parents because that's a much better use of my leaves than having to go to the compost. So if you could see, I don't know if you guys could see this plant, but you know, I'm harvesting from the bottom up and I'm leaving the top, you know, rosette to grow. So, you know, this bottom one, this is the most bottom leaf. So literally I go around to all the bottom leaves, as many as I need, and I'll harvest all the bottom leaves. In addition, if the bottom leaves are hanging over and touching the soil, then I definitely want to harvest it, and you know, they get all the bottom leaves that are more mature, and I have actually more time to collect some of the minerals than the newer growth. In any case, I'm going to go ahead and do that. Maybe I'll speed this up for you guys can see a little bit of my work, and then we will get to showing you guys how I wash and prep and cook the kale. So as you guys can see, I got a big bouquet of greens here. And now I'm going to show you guys actually how I wash and cook these up to make some nice pre-packed meal prep for my parents. All right, first step is to wash the greens. So I know some of you guys might hand wash and the top and bottom of leaves, and sometimes I do that, but most of the time I don't bother. If I was not living in a big city, and there was no major contamination issues around me, I probably wouldn't even wash my greens, so I could actually get the beneficial probiotics that are living on my greens and all the compost, tea, and beneficial microbes that I'm spraying, honestly. But because then I live in a big city, and actually the good thing because of COVID is that there's less flights going overhead, but still, you know, the air is polluted, and then you don't even talk about chemtrails and all this stuff. But anyways, I want to get some of that stuff off my greens. So how I wash is I literally take a clean 5-gallon bucket. This is my food bucket. I usually have something written on there like food only. I put it in my outdoor sink. I put all these greens in inside. And then I basically fill it all up. This is all filtered water. And all the water that comes out of this sink basically goes into buckets, and I carry the buckets, and that's how I got my guns. Because I don't go to the gym, I just literally get work around the homestead, around my house, and I dump the water out to water my different potted trees and whatnot. So we're just gonna go ahead and let this set up and fill up, and then we're gonna come back at you and show you guys how to cook it on up. All right, so now that the greens have been sitting there for a pretty good while, I usually just like to try to grab the whole stems, because I harvest them all the stem side, and I kind of like bring them up and down and agitate them a little bit. You could agitate them a lot more. And if you're anal and want to get it super clean, you may add some salt and or vinegar and or baking soda to your mix. All right, I just add filtered water. Let's see here, and then the next thing is we're gonna go ahead and pull all these guys out, and you can see it's all super wet and there's some particulate in there. I think I see a few aphids, not many. And then I basically dry these. So the cool thing to dry these guys, because we're just gonna basically cook it in water anyways, I hold it all together and then I just swing it super fast. And you can see all the water flinging off. And I usually do this over the raised beds so they get a little bit of water at the same time. So I'm going to go ahead and spin dry this really quick. All right, so let me go ahead and show you guys actually how I'm gonna cook all this. I love preparing food in my outdoor garden here that I just have a table set up, and then you guys saw a little sink. That way I could, you know, just be amongst my plants. More importantly, get some sun, get some fresh air, and you know, be outside because the weather's so nice. And even if it's 50 degrees out, maybe 55, I'll be out here, you know, and harden myself off to the cold weather and probably, you know, building up my immune system at the same time through a little bit of cold tolerance, all right? So all I'm gonna cook up in this episode here is the kale. You can see a whole mound of kale here. In addition, I don't just like to cook them straight kale. I want them to get some calories from the food. Kale does not have a lot of calories. It's about 100 calories per pound. So I like to add in like a butternut squash. So squash is a fruit. Fruit in general contains, 300 calories per pound. I'm not exactly sure how much butternut has, but definitely it has a lot more calories than the leafy greens. So this is full of phytonutrients on the leafy greens, the butternut squash. And the butternut squash is a storage squash. So you could have grew this in your summertime garden and then stored it, and then, you know, still eat it months later. You know, these are not my homegrown onions because I used all the onions I grew. I don't grow a lot of onions. But you could, you know, I encourage you guys to, I mean, you could literally grow all this food yourself. I have videos on how to grow mushrooms, and I've grown butternut in the past, and I surely grow onions when they're in season. I don't have any right now, but this is all organic otherwise, or local. So yeah, I'm just gonna go ahead and cut up onions. I got the mushrooms already pre-cut. We're gonna chop up the butternut into little cubes, and we're gonna chop up all the kale. And then we're just gonna go ahead and cook it in the Instant Pot. The Instant Pot is amazing. All this will basically cook in 3 minutes under pressure, although it takes some time to get up to pressure. And then I let it go on the cooling cycle, you know, for a fair bit before I pull it out and bottle it up for them. So actually I had this running earlier because when I do batch cooking for them or meal prep, I'll try to just do a whole bunch in one day and then just bring it over at night. And then they have it in the fridge for the next week. So we're going to go ahead and pull this off, and what you guys see inside the Instapot, if you guys can see it, is I just basically cooked them purple potatoes. These are not purple sweet potatoes. These are just straight up purple potatoes. So what I like to do is I like to cook the potatoes. I'll do like this main meal with greens, squash, mushrooms, onions, and sometimes I'll add like peppers if I have any extra. And then I also will cook them either purple potatoes. Usually I like to give them the little baby ones, or I'll do sweet potatoes. Like last week I did sweet potatoes with zucchini. This week it's just purple potatoes. Now I do encourage you guys to eat purple potatoes instead of standard potatoes. The purple potatoes have the purple anthocyanin pigments that are actually make them even healthier. You know, these guys I was able to get at a local health food store, Natural Grocers, and it was about $1.69 a pound. So they do cost a bit more, you know, than the standard russets, but they're definitely worth it. And these are just basically cooked, and I just basically pack them in these jars, one jar, and then I vacuum seal them. I have other videos on how to do that, not on this channel. And then I'll basically just bring it to them, and then they open them up, you know, during the week and take them out as they need. And then actually they could re-vacuum seal them because I gave them the apparatus to do so. All right, so that's one jar. And then we got one more jar to fill up, and then we're going to come back and show you guys how to prep all this food. All right, so now I'm going to prep all this food, and basically what it will entail is super simple. I basically just chopped the bottoms off the mushrooms and chopped them into quarters. And then what I'm going to do is I'm going to basically slice off the outer skin on the onion. Everything gets composted out in the garden here to turn into soil for next year's. All the outside stuff, then I slice it into slices and then slice like half, so I have half rounds basically, and I separate them out. And then I basically will cut the butternut squash up using a metal knife. Very important, you will break a ceramic knife with the butternut. I'll take out the seeds and just chop that into little cubes. And then on the kale, I basically have a ceramic knife, and I'm just gonna slice this up into little shreds and then slice the long way, so I have like little, I don't know, cube things or little pieces. so that it's easier to chew for my parents. They don't get these big, huge leaves. The other reason why I'm doing that, this is very important, is that, you know, the leaves, you're going to basically activate the anti-cancer. So if I just took the whole leaves and shoved them in the pressure cooker and cooked them, you would lose significant anti-cancer benefit from these. Because what we want to do is we want to basically make like we're a bug and eat a piece of the leaf off or a creature. And then when we tear a leaf, it releases the enzymes that converts the glucosinolates into isothiocyanates, which are actually even more cancer protective. So that's why I chop it all up first, as well as the onions. You're basically activating the onions, making it more anti-cancer, you know, by chopping up now and letting them sit a while before you put them into the pressure cooker or before you heat process them. So I'm going to go ahead and cut the kale up first. I'm going to cut the onions up, and then I'm going to cut the butternut, and then we're going to come back at you when I got it all prepped. Alright, so as you guys can see, I got all the food prepped. I basically got the kale all sliced up in little pieces. I cut up all the butternut, added an extra butternut, so I got probably 1 1/4 butternuts. I might just use 1 butternut. Then a couple organic red onions, very important. I like to get colorful foods for my parents, so you know, we got some of my purple kale in here. And each of these ingredients are in here for a specific reason. I'll be showing you guys in a second. And then we got about 1 pound of basically baby Bella organic mushrooms. And I'll rotate the mushrooms. Sometimes I'll use shiitake, sometimes I'll use oysters or whatever I get basically a good deal on. And then each one of these components are in here for a certain reason. So for example, the kale is a very powerful, rich in phytonutrients. It has high protein levels and also, you know, has the beneficial anti-cancer compounds and actually anti-aging compounds. Really good for you, gonna help your liver also to detox. So that's mainly for nutrition, anti-cancer. And then the butternut, as I mentioned earlier, is for the calories. Get some calories in there to add some bulk to the food, also to maybe have a little bit of texture in there. The onions, also a very powerful anti-cancer food as proven by science. Also some good flavor and taste. You know, maybe you're Italian, you add onions and everything. And then the mushrooms, once again, another functional food, right? Those are also anti-cancer, anti-angiogenesis, which is going to prevent, you know, extra blood cells growing if there's like cancer tumors and all this kind of garbage. And also, you know, they're just quite healthy. And all these different foods have different kinds of fiber, plant fibers that are good for us. Animal foods have zippo fiber unless you're eating the stomach and you're eating the fiber from the animals that the animals ate. Okay. So anyways, so really easy to cook up. We're going to go ahead and take the lid off the Instapot. And what I've already done is I have the standard Instapot pot here. And I basically, this is the 6-quart model. And I have a little standoff there in the bottom that you guys can't see. So this little steamer tray is not sitting on the bottom. I put about 2 cups of water on the bottom. And now this basically is a little platform in there. So then I basically put that in. And then I basically just take handfuls of the different items. So I'll put a couple handfuls of the greens to kind of line the bottom, because if you get the squash on the bottom of the stainless steel like steamer tray, it kind of like gets crudded up and the greens don't tend to stick as bad. Once I got a layer of greens, then I'll take a layer of the butternut and kind of just have it kind of like all layered, kind of like we're making lasagna, right? But I'm making cooked, healthy, whole food, plant-based meal for my parents. And then I'll take, you know, just maybe a handful of onions and put a handful of onions in there. And like all these flavors will kind of meld, you know, also too when you cook them all together. So it'll be kind of good. And then we're going to go ahead and take a handful of the mushrooms and kind of spread those around. A little bit lighter on the mushrooms since we don't quite have as many of them. All right. Once we got one layer completed, then guess what? We get to do another layer and completing the layers until we're completely full on the pressure cooker. So I'm going to go ahead and do that off camera, and we're going to come back at you and show you guys how to activate the pressure cooker and show you guys how easy this really is. All right, so I think I'm about full of greens on here on the top. I got the top layer of greens, and the other cool thing is I just love to press this down because this will all become compressed anyways once it's all cooked, and you want to make sure you don't have any leaves hanging up on the lid because that's where it definitely needs to make a good solid seal. So I want to make sure the trim ring on the pot is completely clear. Press that down. I probably could fit a bit more, but I'd usually do two batches. And basically each batch will, fill a mason jar or two. And then we'll put this lid on, lock it into place. You also, very important, there's a little pressure release tab. You need to make sure it's facing, the close position. And then all you do, make sure it's closed all the way. Then all you do is you go ahead and hit the manual button right here. It'll default to 30. We don't need 30, man. All we need to do is just go down to 3 minutes. Now, while it is gonna cook for 3 minutes, it's only gonna cook under pressure for 3 minutes. So once we set it to 3 minutes, what'll happen is in a second, the machine will automatically turn on without you having to press anything else. And then it'll basically start, it just came on. So now what's happening is the pressure cooker is coming up and it's basically gonna boil the water into steam. The steam will then fill the little chamber. This thing is locked in, so the pressure is gonna build up inside the chamber. And then the pressure, so basically you're steaming the food under pressure, which reduces the amount of cook time it takes. It may take, I don't even know how long it takes to get up to pressure, because as this is going, I'm going to do something else. Actually, I got to go eat my dinner that I have pre-made, because I meal prepped my food 2 days ago. We're going to go ahead and let this get up to pressure, and then cook. It'll cook for 3 minutes, and then after it's done cooking, then I'll let it naturally depressurize, which could take about 10 minutes. And it'll be on like L for low, and it'll count up, and then we'll see when I get back, and then we'll finish off this video and show you guys actually how I'm gonna go ahead and bottle this up for my parents for the week. All right, so as you guys can see, the pressure cooker is actually on L40. That's because it's actually finished its cycle, and it's been actually sitting on low for the last 40 minutes since I was off eating my dinner and taking a break. So we're gonna go ahead and unpack the pressure cooker, and we're going to show you guys actually how I store it under vacuum for my parents for the week. So the first thing is, on the back of the pressure cooker, you have to release the steam, which there should be none, before opening. And then we're going to go ahead and take the top off, and as you guys can see, all the steam's coming off. And you can see our cooked greens in there. So what I do is I store them in wide mouth mason jars. We basically have two of them. And then I have just the mason jar lids. I have a food saver lid adapter so I can pull a vacuum on it. It's designed to work with the food saver, but the food saver doesn't give a good enough vacuum, and the stronger the vacuum, in my opinion, the longer the food will stay fresh. We have a canning funnel, stainless steel. And then I have the blend tech that is not yet released when this video is being made, although it will be released soon. That actually is the strongest vacuum pump for food use that actually has a built-in evacuation should you suck liquid through it. So I also use this to store my juices as well as my pre-made salads using the same technique. And then finally, because this is quite hot and I don't want to like crush up some of the food that I cooked, I use some tongs, so I simply go ahead and grab a tong full, and I'll bring this over, and basically just put it in. I try to get like equal portions of the squash and all the greens and the onions into the jar, so that each jar has like kind of like the similar format. So as I'm filling these up, I'll basically just come and I'll tap the bottom down to force all the stuff down. I guess you could mash it down, but I don't want it to be super mashed in there. And then usually what I find is that one container full or one Instapot fill will be able to basically fill two jars up pretty much to the top. So here's the last of it coming out of the Instant Pot, out of a little steamer tray that I have sitting in there. And when I fill up the jars, what I try to do is I try to get under the shoulder of the jar and kind of have a little bit of head space in there Normally what I'll do is I'll let these cool off a little bit and let some of the excess steam off before I seal them, but tonight I will just go ahead and seal them. So I'll put the lid on. I'll then put the food saver attachment on. I will then hit the vacuum pump and turn it on. And it'll basically just suck out all the excess oxygen out of the container so that it'll store for as long as possible. It'll also force the air out, so that'll actually force this lid down so it'll be fully sealed without the oxygen. If I store the food in this way, I find easily it can last for up to 7 days in the fridge because there'll be basically no oxygen in there for any kind of bacteria or mold or anything to grow. And then when my parents are ready to eat it, they'll basically just lift up on this and they'll have to kind of break the vacuum seal. Usually you could put like a little knife to like wedge it in there to open it up if you're unable to just literally use your nails and pull up to release the vacuum. Then it shuts off. I can pull that off, and as you guys can see, this lid is sucked down, not through like some kind of canning method, but just from pulling all the excess oxygen out. The oxygen is evacuated, and now it's basically totally sealed and solid on there. I'll then kind of like, and you guys can see what it looks like. I'll then put this in the fridge and then take it, to them cold, and then they'll put it in their fridge and then they could reheat it or just open it up and eat it because it is actually already pre-cooked. This still does need to be stored, in the fridge despite it being pulled the vacuum on it. I would not want to keep this out of the fridge. You want to keep this as cold as possible. All right, so while that one's filling up the next vacuum, we're gonna go ahead and put our next round of the greens in, which is basically the rest of all the ingredients that I've prepped this time. So as you guys can see, we got the Instant Pot filled up for the next round. Once again, we're just gonna go ahead and put the top back on. Seal it up, make sure this little thing is in the closed position, and once again, we could go ahead and hit the stop. We're gonna go ahead and hit the on, turn it on manual, and crank that down to, 3 minutes. And we're gonna go ahead and let the Instant Pot cook for the second batch. Pull off this, pull this out, and once again, check the vacuum. Looks like we got it in our vacuum. And there we go. I got basically 2 quart-sized jars of my fresh kale that's behind me, the butternut squash, the onions, and the mushrooms. We're gonna go ahead and put that in the fridge. We're gonna go ahead and let this cook up. And I would do all this stuff off camera, but that's pretty much how I've made, like now I've made probably 4 quarts. Of this guy, and I also have 2 quarts of those pearl potatoes that I pulled out earlier. I'm also going to give them 2 quarts of my raw soup, that was made with greens from my garden, from the other side of my garden, including the purple mizuna, purple bok choy, and as well as I got a lot of Napa cabbage in there this time. I have videos on my other channel on how I make my raw soup. But yeah, that's pretty much how you make a pretty much simple and easy and healthy cooked meal. Oh, and I forgot to say, the other thing is when you take this out for extra added bonus, you want to sprinkle on some onion or garlic powder, as well as broccoli or radish microgreen powder afterwards to increase the anti-cancer properties from the garlic and the onions because of the active enzymes in those raw powders, with these guys. And then enjoy and eat. Or you could do that actually, if you let this fully cool, you could add those powders to the jar, but these guys are still too warm to add those powders to for extra added benefit. So that's my first and ever episode on YouTube, how to basically cook your food. Because normally I prepare it all raw for myself, but this is a little bit easier to digest for my parents. But that being said, if they drank juice, I'd rather juice my kale for them. But hey, this actually will fill your stomach up a lot more and contains a lot more fiber than juice ever would. So Anyways, if you guys enjoyed this episode on learning how I prepare food for my parents and would like to see more videos on me preparing food and teach you guys how to prepare the food that you guys grew yourself, because as much as my videos online, I have most videos on this channel anyways on, growing the food, I also prepare all my food that I grow from scratch. I don't eat like processed food and all this garbage. And I am literally a chef behind the scenes with all my food, and I've actually been preparing healthy food even longer than I've been gardening, you know, since I started eating a healthful and made major dietary changes back in 1995. If you guys enjoyed this episode, hey, please be sure to give this video a thumbs up, and I'll do more videos like this. Also, please be sure to share this with somebody else so that they could learn some healthy, food preparation techniques so that you and your family and friends could now eat healthier. Also, be sure to click that subscribe button right down below so you never miss out on my new and upcoming episodes coming out every 5 to 7 days. You never know where I'll show up or what be learning on my YouTube channel. And make sure you click the bell so you get notified as my new videos come out. Finally, be sure to check my past episodes. My past episodes are worth a watch. I have about a handful of episodes through the years, you know, where I show how I prepare my food that I grow. But also, you will learn in many episodes how to grow the most nutrient-dense foods on the planet in your own backyard or property. So with that, my name is John Kohler with growingyourgreens.com. We'll see you next time. And until then, remember, keep on growing.